management, recently being placed with Amazon as a team manager. And Amrita has also been a personality development lecturer for quite some time now and give training to the students in the field of business management for interviews, grooming, body language, and communication. She is driven by her passion to enable individuals achieve immense growth through enhancement of creativity, productivity, and prosperity. She brings with her dynamic knowledge and expertise in the realm of effective communication and life skills. She is known for her inspirational talks and relentless efforts in making her training programs a great success through sheer dedication, commitment, and hard work. She is a perfect example of dog determination. So we again welcome Ms. Amrita Ludhwani. So I would now over to you, Ms. Amrita Ludhwani. Please continue.
Thank you so much, Vishali, for your kind words. Hi, Mr. Shekhar. It's really nice to be here. If you guys don't mind, I'm actually waiting for my co-speaker, and I am hoping a couple of my own friends to join. So let's just wait for a minute, and I can see a lot of people joining still. So let's just give this a minute, and once everybody is in place, we can start in a minute or two. Is that okay, Captain Shekhar?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Is that
it's,
okay?
It's fine. It's perfectly okay.
Okay, perfect, perfect. So we'll just wait for another minute or two.
And no issue. No problem.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. So, Mr. Shekhar, I think we're good to go.
Yeah, just.
Sure.
Amrita, you are the host now.
Yeah.
You can go ahead.
Yeah, can you please also make Mr. Anubhav Sharma the host?
You can make him the host.
Okay, okay. I'll just.
You are the host now.
Okay. Okay.
Did you inquire about the polling thing?
Yes, it's there on your screen. So if you go to the past participant section, you'll get the polling options there.
How about you do it for me? That'll be better, right?
It's there on your screen. So when you go to your participants section, you'll find the option of yes and no. So you can poll there. Like you can ask for the polling there.
Figure out where is it.
Okay, so I guess we're good to go.
Yes, you can.
Okay, perfect, perfect. So, hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Very good afternoon to all of you. First things first, I'd like to thank and welcome you all to the session on the Art of Communication, which is as hosted by Aircrews Aviation Private Limited India. Let me introduce you to the speakers of this session. So, of course, I can see a lot of people here who know me already. But for those who don't know me, my name is Amrita Ludhwani, and I am a recent postgraduate, being a gold medalist in the field of marketing, operations, and information management. I have also been a personality development and motivational speaker. And one of my recent achievements was that I got placed with Amazon as a team manager, being a fresher. Today with me, I am honored to introduce you to the co-host, the guest speaker of the session, who's going to speak with me, Captain Anubhav Sharma. So he's an airline pilot, and even he has had a long time training people in the field of personality development, spoken English, verbal, non-verbal communication, soft skills. So I'll welcome you, Mr. Anubhav Sharma, and so basically, for everybody's knowledge here, this session is divided into two parts. One that I would like Mr. Sharma to take over for about, you know, how he has been training a lot of people for now. And then the later part of it, the part that will include how communication is going to change in this particular COVID era and post-COVID era. I'm going to take on that. So I request now Mr. Anubhav Sharma to take over and start with the session.
All right. First of all, thank you very much, Ms. Amrita Ludhwani, for your kind words. I hope each and every one of you who's attending this session, first of all, I congratulate each one of you. The reasons are two. It's very simple. First of all, the zeal that you've shown by attending this webinar to learn something productive, even in the situations when they're not really good. Secondly, is I would like to congratulate you on a personal basis. Why? Because some of you, in fact, all of you have been unsung heroes. Why? Considering the times that are there right now, most of us have helped our family members, our friends, our relatives, or for that matter, anyone who's been there. Even if you've heard somebody on the phone and you've helped them out, you've done a great job. As a college, as a city, as a state, as a nation, we really stand together proud right now. So congratulations to each one of you for battling this pandemic and doing a great, great job. Now, I remember a couple of years back, I was traveling with my friends to this town of beautiful town in Himachal. And like a regular tourist, what we decided was that we'll go, we'll sightsee, we'll eat some local food and come back. We saw all the possible places in that particular town, had authentic food that was provided to us by people who were catering. one fine day we were sitting and we were having lunch. So हम लोग खाना खा रहे थे और साथ में एक ड्राइवर बैठा हुआ था. He was also having lunch at a particular dhaba. Now what happens is that we started chit-chatting. As when we go out, we end up talking to the locals, right? Every one of us does that when we travel. So I spoke to that guy and he asked us, "Ki sir, आपने क्या क्या देखा है?" So we went on the list and we told him that, you know, we saw this, that. Being a localite, you always know better, right? He advised us, "Ki sir, यहाँ पे एक particular peak है, आप लोग वहाँ जाओ, and you'll get the most magnificent view that you've ever seen. And because you could see the particular Himalayan belt from that particular range." And all of us were intrigued. Now, just ask this question to yourself. How many of you would have actually gone ahead and climbed that hill, considering that hill had almost an incline of 70 degrees, plus it had all the obstacles like a kacha rasta, the rain that you could get, the mud you could get? How many of you would have done that? I'm sure a lot of you would say yes to it, right? The point is, now if I ask you that, are you a trained mountaineer or do you have a professional training certificate for trekking? Well, most of you will not have it. That, ladies and gentlemen, is my point. You in life, to achieve those magnificent views, to achieve those heights, have to actually scale up your skills, which actually make you reach from the current position that you are to the place that you wish to be. There's a lot of difference. You have to acquire those skills. And in today's webinar, I'm going to take you through the art of communication under the three basic skills of learning, which come under the art of communication. I call them the three musketeers, which is speaking, listening, and expression. I, Anubhav Sharma, your personality development coach, verbal, nonverbal communication, and a soft skill trainer, will take you to the grassroots of this and explain you, relating to the examples from my own life, that can be relatable to your life as well. The first point, the foremost point in the art of communication is speaking. All of us are born, we are born as babies. Without any skill, we are all the same in this planet, right? Over the time, we end up acquiring the skill set, right? I remember at a very, very early age, probably when I was just out of school, I was sitting on a Sunday afternoon with my father, and like a typical Indian dad, he asked me that, "Beta, tumhari 12th khatam ho gayi. So what do you exactly wish to do?" And I looked at him and I told him that I wish to be a pilot, and you know, I want to pursue this as a career because I'm pretty passionate about it. So, as a strict Indian father that he is, he asked me that, "Okay, we'll get this done for you. I'll help you. But you need to prove it to me that you're capable of handling that level of stress, that you can go through what it takes to become that particular man who's skilled enough to fly a giant metal body in the air." I looked at him with an exclamation mark. "Ki, matlab, Dad, what do you want me to prove? आप बताओ क्या करना है, I'll do it." वो अपनी चेयर पे रुके, उनकी एक पर्टिकुलर रॉकिंग चेयर है, he got it from there. And he picked up a Hindustan Times newspaper. Now that particular newspaper had an advertisement of a hotel, from a hotel management chain, one of the biggest in India, for a vacancy. There were a couple of vacancies certainly. So he points towards it and he tells me that, you know, get through this. This is what you need to do. And again, I looked at him with an exclamation. I was like, "But ye hotel management hai, aur mujhe karna kuch aur hai." He's like, "Son, the point is not that. The point is that you can learn and you can prove something out of your comfort zone." I agreed. I was like, "All right, I'll do this." 3-4 months, I got my head buried into books, to my teachers, to whatever I could do in life as a naive teenager, I did. With God's grace and everything that I could possibly think of, I ended up clearing all the rounds for that elite hotel's interviews, right? And so the last round, I genuinely saw people who were elder to me, people who were of my age, 18. There was one thing common between all of them, across the table, across those chairs, there was one thing that was certainly common. It was the way they spoke. जो उनके बात करने का तरीका था, I mean, I was hooked कि मेरी एज के लोग या मेरे से बड़ी एज के लोग इस तरीके से बात करते हैं जो मैंने कभी देखा नहीं है. When I was walking out of that room that particular day, at 18, मुझे बहुत अच्छी तरह समझ आ गया था कि जिंदगी में अगर आगे बढ़ना है, कुछ करना है, तो सबसे अच्छी जो चीज है, जो सबसे बड़ी चीज है, आपको बोलना आना चाहिए. बोलना as in you need to know how to speak fluently with the right amount of knowledge, the right amount of skill to deliver what it takes for that particular place or for that particular situation. That was the power of speaking introduced to me at a very, very early age. You have knowledge, agreed. Most of us have these days, right? Hum log sab padhte hain. Indian system mein, we are bound to study. We are born with books and we go years and years reading those books. But what about the fact that, ladies and gentlemen, if you're unable to deliver what you know, there comes the point, right? Learn, develop that skill set of how to speak, how to present. It is going to take you places from where you're sitting right now to probably somewhere that you did not even think you could reach. You will be there. Let me come to the second point. I often call it as a silent killer. One of my favorites is called listening. What happens is there's a little story attached to this as well. Aur ye hum sab ne experience kara hai, personally experience kara hai. When you're a kid, हम लोग usually अपने parents के साथ अपने relatives के घर जाते हैं या अपने पूरी family के साथ या उनके friends के घर जाते हैं, right? हर Indian बच्चे में एक trait होता है बचपन में, when you're young, कि हमें हमेशा ये लगता है कि सामने वाले के घर का खाना ज्यादा अच्छा है. What we do is we end up filling our plates, you know, for more than what is required. अब जब आप ये चीज कर रहे हो, when you're filling your plate, there's a particular thing. If you look into your mother's eye, she's not going to say anything to you. She's going to be really calm and composed. All she's going to do is, when you come out somewhere, she's going to tell you, what is this? Just two words. What is this? Can you stop it? That is the power of listening to you. When you hear those two words, you automatically deceive within those two words that I am not supposed to be doing this. Forget about a sentence. This is what you hear, right? And after that, you become a well-behaved kid. That is taught to you from the base root position. Now, once this happened, that I was training initially, you know, I had to get into Jet Airways and I had an interview for that. There was a particular training that had to be acquired. So I went to Calcutta all the way to this, one of the strictest guys ever known to the aviation for pilots. His name was Wing Commander Mukherjee. I was all geared up. Mujhe laga ye jo bolenge, main sab kuch likh lunga. एक पेन और पेपर लेकर वी स्टार्टेड द क्लास. आई हैड अ फ्रेश रजिस्टर, आई हैड अ पेन. ही स्टार्टेड स्पीकिंग, आई स्टार्टेड राइटिंग. इन 3 मिनट्स ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर क्लास, ही लुक्ड एट मी एंड ही टोल्ड मी, अनुभव, क्लोज योर रजिस्टर, क्लोज योर पेन, कीप इट डाउन. एंड आई लुक्ड एट हिम एंड आई आस्क्ड हिम, सर व्हाई? How do you expect me to retain this? Because I've been in this system since school. He told me one line that is still stuck on my head, which is, you're here to be a pilot, not a clerk. Listen, adapt, process, and deliver. This was the power of listening that I'd got from him. When it actually comes to processing knowledge, when we listen to something, we are able to deliver better. I'll give you a very layman's example, which is, there's a tank of water, right? And supposedly water is pouring in and the tank gets filled. Now, when you open the tap, the water gushes out, right? Consider that tank to be your brain and that water to be the knowledge that is your brain is absorbing. And when you start speaking, ladies and gentlemen, you speak with confidence that you get. That is the power of listening. Because once you listen properly, you have that material in your head that is ready to be delivered, right? You can literally put it in a platter and deliver. A patient listener is a very important quality that all of us should have to deliver that amount of knowledge at that particular point of time. Kitni baar hum sabke saath ye hua hai ki we are sitting in an exam and just because ek point of time pe hum ek teacher ke ek lesson mein attentive the, to hume wo answer wahan pe yaad aata hai and we end up writing it in that particular exam. That is the power of your listening. That triggers in your subconscious mind on certain levels. Always try and listen first. Right? Listen and then speak. We all know it very well. Coming on to the third and the last musketeer, one of my favorites, the power of expression, often called as non-verbal communication. Again, I'll take you back to your family days. It's very, very slow and easy process because all of us can relate to our families and Indian families and whatever happens. As kids, we used to go to our relative space as a family, right? At times, agar aapki mom ko wo time nahi mila ki wo aapko andar le jaake kuch bole ki beta aur plate mein mat dalo hamari izzat ka sawal, theek hai? Being a strict parent, if you've had a strict parent, she would not take you into the room and tell you this. Mind it. What she would do is, you pick up one more kaju barfi or samosa, look into her eyes. What she's going to do is, she's going to raise an eyebrow. And you, my friend there, you will be back to your respective place where you are. That is the power of expression to you. She will not say anything to you. You will not hear a word from her. Yet, you will be in your place. All the way from your childhood into an Indian home, going up to the world leaders. You see the summits, the economic summits, G7, G8 summits, whatever happens, look at the world leaders, look at their body language, look at their posture. Talk about Tony Blair, talk about Barack Obama, talk about Vladimir Putin, you name the leaders. Everybody goes through these trainings of expressions, which is non-verbal communications. I'll tell you, this, the position, look at my hands like this. This is called steeple. Google it. You'll come to know. You'll get multiple world leaders sitting in this position, the steeple position. It executes power. It executes calmness. Power of expression is right from your childhood all the way to the world leaders that are there, right? Learn this power of expression, because in your interviews or wherever you go, 60 to 70% is the power of expression. How you walk, how you deliver, how you talk. People are going to observe you even before you start speaking, right? I'd like to conclude this now by giving you a very small Sanskrit shloka, which is Vidya Dhanam Sarvadhanam Pradhanam. That is wealth. You know, wealth. We all think about wealth, but knowledge here is the ultimate wealth that you acquire over time. And how do you acquire it? You acquire it by the skills that you make in life. I, being a trainer, can personally take you through those baby steps where you can be from what you are right now to where you wish to be. Because what we'll do is, in the end of the session, during the Q&As, we will put up our respective contacts, and from there you can pick up and contact us for your information. So one more question. I'll tell you guys a couple of more things, not really related to communication, but overall development, basic question in life. How many of you if you actually think you have 1 hour left, mind it, 1 hour, after that, you are saying goodbye to this world, right? How many of you think you would have chosen money? You would have money, or how many of you would have chosen that you would have impacted the lives of people? I'm sure most of you, if you think in your subconscious mind, you would have chosen the path of impacting people's lives, right? Get that skill set. Impact the lives. This is what you're here for impacting, for empowering, for influencing. Deliver what needs to be delivered by you. And if I can do it, even you can do it. You have it in you. Just that you need to do what needs to be done. You need to leave that comfort zone. I can actually help as to how you need to leave that comfort zone, right? And moreover, most of us think that if we get money, we'll be happy. If we get a promotion in my job, I'm going to be happy. And materialistic things, basically, right? Howard University, one of the biggest institutions known to the mankind at present in the 21st century, right? They conducted a research for over 75 years. And there were multiple heads, because certainly you could not have one head for 75 years. They had multiple heads. They took people for their experiments and they observed them when they were with their families, when they had sorrows, when they had fears, when they had anxieties, when they had depression, when they were happy, when they were eating. They were observed, like, you know, in detail from a particular age bracket till a certain age. After 75 years, there was a theory that came up. There was a study, there was a conclusion to it, that what exactly is the key to being happy? It is none other than the quality of your relationships. Yes, you heard me right. The quality of your relationships that you build over time are going to keep you in a very, very happy place. Build, speak, talk, influence, grow, all right? Try and grow. Because once you focus on your growth, you do not get scared. You do not worry about security. But if you worry about security, then you will certainly not be focusing on the growth and security. You will not get both of them. Focus on growth, you'll get growth and security both. That is it from my side for today. And thank you very much for your time. You've been doing great in life, and stay safe and take care of your family. Thank you very much. And over to Ms. Amrita Ladwani now.
So thank you so much, Mr. Sharma, for your wonderful insights. Guys, personally, I am honored to have him here because he's been a personal mentor to me. And all the recent achievements that I've had in my life is because of him. So thank you so much, Anubha, for setting the base for my topic of session now. Okay, so I'll be beginning here with a small story. So there was this girl having a little challenging past. Now, I won't waste your time in defining what the kind of challenges she went through. But then she had a hard time growing up, and the only way for her to prove herself, to make the world realize what's her worth, was that she had to do something worthwhile, so people start respecting her, so people actually get influenced from her. So just like every other teenager, even that girl was confused, what she can be doing, whether she should go about doing a lot of certifications, diploma, courses, learning languages. She really had no clue as to what she should be doing. She should get into sports. She had no idea. So one day, one of her mentors told her to first master the art of communication. And this didn't really get into her head because she was like, that's not how I can prove myself. To prove myself, maybe I need to get all India ranks and, you know, do a lot of certifications, have a lot of degrees and diplomas. How on earth is communication going to help me? From that day to now in 11 years, that girl knows that when you are able to master the art of communicating to people, that's when at the end of the day, everything eventually falls into place. And trust me, that happens. I'll tell you why. 24 hours in a day, 365 days in a year, all of us spend our time communicating to people, right? Even if you're not communicating to people, you are communicating to yourself. And when you're doing that, you are posing an impression on everybody that you meet, be it your boss, be it your friends at school, be it your faculties, be it your emails, be it verbal, nonverbal, be it anything. We do realize that we are social animals. And that's where the point comes. The moment you know how to communicate properly, how to use everything that Mr. Sharma just mentioned about, you know, listening and expressions, body language, your vocabulary, your words. When all of this falls in line, that's the key where now, even if you take up any of the most difficult certifications or diplomas or anything that you want to achieve in the world, you can do that by having mastered your communication skills. You can network better, you can learn better, you can express yourself better. So you can know a lot of, you can have known a lot of law books, you can have known a lot of content, knowledge, but there's no point of any of it if you can't deliver it in the right manner. Today, in this session, I will not bore you with the basics of communication. So if you go to Google, of course, you'll find hundreds and thousands of videos on communication, on 7 C's of communication, on ways of communication, on how you can, you know, write better, how you can make your vocabulary better, how you can type better emails, how you can speak better in public. But then I wanted to bring to your attention the recent most keys to better communication. Now, I have 3 points in mind and I will take you through them one by one. A very recent example, this COVID pandemic. So, you know, even before this COVID pandemic, everybody was rushing through. Everybody was, you know, in a rat race, in a marathon of, you know, having a bigger bungalow, of having, you know, expensive cars, expensive mobile phones, showing off the things that you have. And such an irony that, you know, everything came to a standstill. And we just sort of started realizing the importance of hugging each other, having those small moments of intimacy, kissing each other, meeting your friends. We just realized that at the end of the day, it's you, it's me, and it's the human race. It's all the living organisms. It's plants, it's animals. It's us. I mean, at the end of the day, we just realized that, you know, hum jitni bhi Bombay ki local trains ki aur wo Delhi ki metros ki bhag daur mein lage hue the, it just came to a standstill and everybody just realized that at the end of the day, it was you, it was your family, it was your friends, it was your wife, your husband, your kids. Everybody just, you know, realized the importance of mankind, of humans, of showing love to each other. I even saw people with really cold hearts turning, you know, very sweet people and started expressing themselves. Because until now, we just started taking each other for granted. That's how it was happening. That's why my very first point is coming. Emotions. So yes, you can talk about being clear. You can talk about being concise in your communication. You can talk about being concrete. You can talk about all the 7 C's of communication. But now the new key to communicate. In this era and the post-COVID era, is keeping your emotions alive. So many things, so many people changed during this time. People realize that the Mercedes parked outside your house doesn't matter. You matter. People living in your home matter. Your friends matter. This might sound a little stupid to you right now, but then try doing this. Maybe in your next interview or when you are speaking to somebody, try empathizing with them. Try, you know, getting into their shoes, into the situation that they are. Try on a more, you know, to talk on a more emotional and personal level. And trust me, that's where you're going to make the difference, because this is exactly the difference that is now going to come in the sort of communication that will be happening from now. Let me give you a very basic example. And ye hum sab karte hai, let me tell you. Hame kahin se bhi bahana banana ho, pehle ke zamane mein, like before this COVID thing. Hamare liye bahut acha bahana hota tha ki doctor kya jana, ya I'm in the hospital. So, my point here is that, you know, today, even if you're hearing from a stranger that, you know, he's about to visit a hospital or he's about to go to a clinic or something, we immediately, you know, try to ask them that, is everything all right? Is everything doing okay? That's where these things come from. The next key, other than those 7 C's of communication that we've known about and we've learned about in our theoretical classes, the next key to your effective communication this moment onwards is bringing emotions. Now, a lot of people, you know, a lot of people will ask me, maybe later, I don't know, but you certainly will have the question that how am I supposed to express emotions during an interview? Because certainly that's not a place where you show your emotions, right? That's a place where you show the practical side of yourself. So let me give you an example here as well. My latest interview with Amazon, so there were like 100 students who participated, hardly 2 to 3 got selected. What was that one thing that those 2-3 students did different from the rest of them? It was very simple. We weren't talking about, you know, decreasing the costs and increasing the profits and, you know, all those metrics of sales and conversions. You know what we talked about? I mean, I personally, we talked about the values, the ethics, the mission and vision that we share with the company. How, as an individual, you are able to relate to the company, to the people of company, to all those people who are working with you. How can you relate to them? How can you share that culture with them? This is where, again, the emotion side of, you know, your professional life comes from. It's not anymore about money. It's about the wealth that you create over time, the goodwill. And this comes from the value system, the mission and vision system, the belief system. So next time when you are interviewing for a company, get a little emotional, not in the sense that you have to share your personal stories, but on the way that you start sharing the value system of the company, the belief system of the company. This, I want you to keep in mind one part, emotion. This is the next big thing that will be coming with all the changes that communication is going to, an effective communication is going to make in the times to come. Second, my point is be your true self. Today, I see so many resumes, and since I train a lot of people, a lot of people come with me with their interviews, you know, like their video CVs, which is in trend like right now a lot. And I don't understand that every video that I go through, it has the same beginning, it has the same end, and it has the same content. Even when I meet people outside, you know, like generally meeting my friends, everybody's following a same pattern of communicating. of having their bases laid, of talking, of building their content. And I'll tell you why this originality has lost. This originality has lost because now we have sample videos and sample communication types available on Google and internet. And we don't put our brains and we just go about using all of that and implying it in our video CVs and maybe just, you know, generally talking to people or, you know, maybe in our emails or when we talk to bosses or when we make our presentations for that matter. So anything and everything we do, we just take it from Google. We don't even care of, you know, amending it based on our interest or the kind of things I believe in. And we just go about it like that. Now, this is my second point in an effective communication. Try to be more original with the thoughts that you have, the things that you believe in. This is going to be the second most important key in an effective communication. The next time, maybe you said in an interview, maybe you are looking into a career growth, maybe you are speaking publicly with your friends. I just see that the thing of originality is now lacking. So two things that I've spoken about not yet. One, emotion. Second, bringing out your true self. Stop using those. See, because of course, there are not 7 billion different ways on the internet available for you, right? Stop getting scared of the fact ki log kya sochenge ya maine aisa bol diya to log kya sochenge. Trust me, every great invention that has happened in the world was criticized once. A lot of companies, when they were launched, when they were incorporated, they were criticized for their ideas. And today those companies are blue chip companies that are now in your schedule, in your routine, day in and day out, and they are doing amazing. All the great things that happened were criticized on their day one. And yes, I'm not saying you won't be criticized for your unique ways of interacting, but trust me, after a point, and anything, everything that I'm talking about right now, it is tried and tested. Like, I've tested it on myself and it is tried and tested on a lot of people. So you really, I just want you to bring out true self of yours. Stop thinking, there's no module. There's nothing that says, okay, this is how you should start beginning to communicate and this is how you should be ending. No, have and build your own original things, your way of communicating. It's you. You need to understand that. If artificial intelligence can know and understand that this face is different for 7 billion people and this fingerprint when you use it on your phone is different for 7 billion people, it is okay to have your own style of communication and bringing out your own self, whether it be an interview, a general conversation, or whatever it be. So this was my second point. Now, third and very, very important and final from my side, self-discipline. Now, you'll think, what is the relation of communication with self-discipline? Trust me, about the girl that I started to talk about in the start of this session. She took 10 to 11 years to bring herself to where she is today. Trust me, she was criticized to a very great extent. She's still criticized, by the way. But then she has found her own unique ways to have her footprint in the life of others, being a friend, being a girlfriend, being a kid, being a daughter, being an influencer. She's just been there in a lot of parts. And the only reason she was able to do this was because of self-discipline. You can master the art of communication and all the extra points that I spoke that, you know, now will come and will be included in art of communication. It's going to come through self-discipline. Unless and until you make promises to yourself, you are not making promises here to anybody else. You are doing this for yourself. This was for yourself from day one. You start doing it for yourself. You continue to do this for yourself, even if it takes the next 10 years. Because trust me, not that 10 years, the graph is going to go like this, it's going to jump like this. No, it's going to have a steep like this. And even if it takes you 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, that clock, that cycle of improving yourself never ends. Even today, I'm going to learn a few things from this session. Maybe, you know, after the session, I'll pen down the kind of mistakes I made, the kind of mistakes Mr. Sharma made, and the kind of things that, you know, maybe me and Mr. Sharma will take care not to do that the next time, or the things that we can do better. Me and Mr. Sharma will still sit down and, you know, entire with the aviation, these guys, we're going to sit down and pen down the things that they can do in the further sessions to improve. That is self-discipline. Not for to show you guys, not to show anybody else, but for ourselves. And that girl has been doing this for the past 10 to 11 years now. And a lot of people actually believe in improving themselves day by day. So I'll just summarize these 3 points for you again. Other than those 7 C's of communication that I will not bore you with, you can just Google them, you'll find them, you can practice them at your home, in your regular interviews, meetings, mails, regular routine job, being anybody, talking to yourself, whatever works for you. But then the new 2 things that are going to really work and the things that are going to now change with how you communicate is going to be 1, emotions, and 2, originality. That is bringing yourself out and not just copy-pasting the ideas and the way of others. Because you are an original self and you're worth it. These 2 things. And 3rd, that, you know, all the 7 C's and these 2 cannot be possible without self-discipline. So I guess this was from me and from Mr. Sharma's side. We are now open to take questions. You wish you can unmute yourself and ask a question one by one. You can put it in the chat box. And if you want one of us to specifically take the questions, we'll be happy to do that. I believe communication is a matter of a little personal matter, even if not here in front of everybody. If you wish to personally get in touch with us, I'll shortly be showing you the you know, the details where Mr. Sharma can be reached out and where I can be reached out. And if you want to get your issues resolved personally, we'll be happy to do that. But for now, if you have any questions, please, we're open for that now.
Guys, are you able to hear me properly?
Yes.
Just write in the chat section if you can. Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Is everyone able to hear loud and clear?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, I think I'll be rejoining because I think there's some technical glitch. I was not able to hear Amrita properly. So let me just quickly rejoin you guys in a couple of seconds.
Okay, so in the meanwhile, does anybody have any sort of questions or... Yeah, please,
Daniel,
go ahead.
Ma'am, my question is that how can be a person will be effective communicative when someone is not when someone does not want to hear you? But means my question is that how can be the person be effective and good communicator when his communication skill is not good?
Okay. So Tanmay, I'll answer this question to you. There are 3-4 sides to this, okay? One that I mentioned by the end of my session was that you need to be self-disciplined. Now, by self-disciplined here, I mean that you need to invest in yourself the time that you need to improve, right? So even I'm not perfect today. Even I have to learn a lot of things, even if it comes on a matter of communication. So what do? I read a lot daily. So I read novels. Even before the session, I was standing in front of the mirror and I was practicing the things that I'm going to be talking about with you guys today. So that's where you can improve your communication. you need to first figure out your problem areas, whether your problem area is vocabulary, whether your problem area is speaking fluently, whether your problem area is the fear. So you know, like all of these things can be dealt with individually. Okay. You identify your problem area. If you can do this by yourself, that's great. That's amazing. If you want some help, you can anytime reach out to us. If it's about vocabulary, start reading a lot. If it's about speaking a lot, having that fear, start, you know, participating in group discussions, going out in public, talking to a lot of people, and you'll lose the fear. So the first things first, identify your problem area. Now, the specific question that you asked, that, you know, how can you make other people listen to you when they are not ready to listen to you?
Yes, ma'am.
So first, again, originality. If there are 10 people in a group or 10 mein se 10 log ek hi baare mein baat kar rahe hain, of course, I'm not going to listen to the 11th person because he's saying the same thing. But if you are original in your thoughts and you have something different to offer, then people are certainly going to listen to you. Second, your body language and how you speak, your tone, your pitch, how you are modulating your voice. All of this contributes to how you can make people listen to yourself. Mr. Sharma, do you have any point to add here? So his question was, how can he make people listen to him when they are not ready to listen to him?
Who asked this question? Can you tell me?
It's Mr. Tanmay Sharma.
All right. Hi, Tanmay. How are you?
Sir, I am awesome.
All right. That's extremely confident of you. Good to know that. So your question is how to make people listen to you, right? If the audience is not interested. All right. As a speaker, what I've always understood is it is the duty of the speaker to keep people engaged. It is not the duty of the audience to stay engaged. There's a lot of difference between this. If I'm talking, it's perfectly all right that a group of people are not listening. They can be in their phones. They can be in their own thoughts. At a point, if you are on a stage and somebody is just looking at you, it does not mean that they're listening to you, Tanmay. The point is they can be looking at you, but not listening to you. To engage your audience, start with how you walk. You know, if you've known the fact, a walk defines a lot. Celebrities, people who are at the top post, they have a particular style of walking. That comes under nonverbal communication. That's your attitude. That's your attitude. How do you go by it? 70% of your battle is won just by your body language. And thereafter, it's your content, how you engage. Like I was in a spot like this once where there was a particular section of the audience which was busy in their own thoughts or poking each other. Well, now what happens is you're talking, and if the audience is not listening, it can be really disturbing as a speaker. You feel like you're not doing great enough. Yes. The point to engage then is you directly target that particular audience. Like I came up with a question that, hey, what is the joke going around? Let me become a part of it. And you know, somebody can come here and crack the joke and all of us can laugh. I mean, you need to be friendly. You need to be creative with your own thoughts in how to answer, how to cater to them. And that is, my friend, you will come to know once you start developing those particular skills. All right, Tanmay?
One question answer, sir. Sir, how can we overcome our hesitation in self-confidence?
Can you please repeat it for me?
How can we overcome our fear, hesitation, and self-confidence?
How can you overcome your fear and?
Hesitation and self-confidence.
See, Tanmay, it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of practice. It takes a lot of efforts. And it's a constant hard work. It is a very long journey that you embark. It does not come overnight. I mean, if anybody of you who's going to come to me and tell me that, you know, I need a particular skill set, then you need to give me time to build that skill set. If I do my homework, you need to do your homework. Anybody who you get influenced with, they have had years and years of practice, months of practice, speaking sessions, listening sessions, writing their own content. So you can start with something, but you have to be consistent. Consistency is the key here. All right, let's, is that it, Tanmay? Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so Anubhav, there's a question for you, I guess, that you'll be able to answer better. This question is from Mr. Sparsh Tejwani, and he's asking, can nonverbal communication portray your friendliness? If yes, is it a good thing to happen in an interview?
All right, Sparsh. I am a strong believer in nonverbal communications. That is, I consider that an art, a form of art that goes a long, long way. Now, being friendly in your approach is something that I will not really prefer, because you're going for a professional interview. You're not going for a friendly chat. There's a difference between you being professional and you being friendly. I would cater that you maintain a strictly professional body language and a strictly professional attribute, because once you enter that door, my friend, you are being observed by the number of eyes that are sitting in that particular room. Friendly is the interviewer's gesture. If they try to talk to you in a friendly way, then you should still be reserved in your body language and answer them back. Like, I'll give you an example. Somebody I know, they had an interview. The panel had around 6 people. Now, the point is, a lot of people went, at least 3-4 people went before him, and all of them were grilled badly. Badly means badly. They were grilled on their technical knowledge. They were grilled on the general perspectives of their life, to whatever you can think of. Now, this guy enters, and there are 4 people sitting right in front of you who are top-notch in whatever they do. And what the first thing that he spots is, after entering and taking 3 steps, is that there's a pen, mind it, there is a pen which is lying on the carpet once you enter. And it is there on your path, like slightly 3-4 steps away from your path. And you can see it. That guy goes, picks up the pen, keeps it on a table next to him. And then he walks up, pulls his chair, and takes permission to sit. That guy did manage to clear the interview. What is the point? The point is, he did not miss out on something that other people had missed. The importance of keeping your things in the right place, organizing. And if something does not belong to you, just put it where it has to be. And somebody who caters to it is the best guy for your organization. So nonverbal communication, do not be friendly, be professional. That's not an area to be friendly. Thank you. Thank you, Swash.
Hello.
Hello. Yes. Hello? Who is that speaking?
Sir, ma'am, this is Richa here.
Hi, Richa. Yeah, please.
Ma'am, I have a question. Like, if a person is very much knowledgeable and he's having a knowledge, but he's not unable to express. So in that case, what he or she should do?
Can you repeat the question, please? I could not hear you. Be a bit more louder.
So, like, if someone is very much knowledgeable and he has, right, like, lots of knowledge he's having, but he's unable to express in front of anyone, whether it's be right, interviewer or the teacher. So in that case, what he or she should do?
Well, I think what we'll do is we'll split this answer. 50% Ms. Ludhwani can answer and 50% I'll answer, because she's been pretty recent with the Amazon since we conducted a lot of sessions about expressing. So she would give you a layman's practical insight, and then I can cater to her.
You going first, Anubhav?
No, you going first.
Okay. So hi, Richa. I can certainly understand your concern, because I personally have been through that phase, you know, where I have read a lot of books and, you know, I've gulped a lot of material, but then what's the point of, you know, having all those if you can't, you know, take that out of your mouth at the right time for the right question. So one thing that I have been doing for years now, not just Amazon, but then for years and years, like I've been taking personality development lectures and, you know, doing public speaking and stuff. One thing that I always take care of doing at least 3-4 days before my actual day of delivery is that I mirror practice. And I mirror practice via baby steps. So what I do is I place a lot of questions. So I'm giving you a practical example here, how you can do this. So say suppose you are going to go and sit for an interview. Now, there are always a few expected questions that we as candidates certainly know ki ye company ye sawal to pakka puchegi. We have our alumni telling us that. It's Google telling us that. So there are a lot of things. Aur kuch nahi to strengths, weaknesses, give me your intro. Ye questions to aaye jaate hain, right? What you do is you make small chits of every question that you think can be asked to you. And you also pen down your answers in bullet points under those questions. Isse ek cheez ye hogi that you'll have your thoughts in a structured format now. Abhi aapke paas alphanumeric content, knowledge, sab aapke dimag mein pura cluttered hai, right? Once you start penning it down, it'll start becoming organized. Even for the questions that, you know, you are not expecting or you don't know are going to come. One thing what you can do is, say suppose there is a theory that you remember very vividly and you are thorough with that theory and you master in that theory. And this theory can be your key to get into the company. You pen down that theory as well. You pen down all such things and experience that you have done in the past, you know, your educational life, your internships, whatever it is. You start penning it down. If I mean, I can literally show you right now. I still have my material of Amazon ready here. And I had literally 50 to 60 different chits made. Not that I was using these chits during my interview, but I started mirror practicing these chits. And the day of my interview, I was very organized with the kind of thoughts and the kind of words and things that I had to speak. Kabhi kabhi kya hota hai na with people like us. बहुत ज्यादा चीजें होती है दिमाग में, कभी कभी बहुत ज्यादा ही हो जाती है, इतनी ज्यादा हो जाती है जिनकी जरूरत नहीं होती है, एंड वी एंड अप मेसिंग इट अप. सो दैट्स योर वे, मेक स्मॉल शिट्स, मेक यू नो पेन इट डाउन, मेक इट इन एन ऑर्गेनाइज्ड वे, मिरर प्रैक्टिस इट अगेन एंड अगेन, टाइम एंड अगेन, इवन व्हेन यू आर हैविंग योर मॉर्निंग टी, इवनिंग रूटीन, कॉफी, कीप गोइंग थ्रू दोज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड पैराग्राफ्स इन योर हेड. व्हाट विल हैपन इज ऑन द डे ऑफ योर इंटरव्यू, सो यू स्टिल हैव अ लॉट ऑफ नॉलेज. But then today, it is going to be organized knowledge, which you'll be able to put at the right time for the right question. I think I've answered your query. If not, please let me know how else I can help you.
No, ma'am, it's okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much, Richa. Amazing question. Okay, hello. So I guess we'll take...
Hello?
Yeah. Hi, Poonam. Please tell me.
No, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, I have a question. Like, many of us use our language, use English language while interviewing.
Right.
And as not everyone is fluent in English, and we use some of the Hindi words. Is it right. Like it impact good or bad while using Hindi words, or we should use if we are not comfortable? Like, we should switch or not between language?
Okay. So, Poonam, two parts to this question. One, it really depends on your company. If you're literally getting into companies like, so I won't name them, but then if you're getting into an MNC, which literally deals with US, UK, Singapore based clients, you cannot switch. Okay. But then if you are, you know, maybe getting interviewed for an Indian profile or, you know, a profile that requires a lot of management and operational role, there is no harm in switching for a while. So it's okay. Even I use a few Hindi words when I really have to express myself and when you have to, you know, put a lot of examples. So it really depends on the company, on the profile, the stage that you're at. Okay. The kind of job description that you'll be catering to. But then, honestly, you know, when you are in that flow, when you are having that confidence, when you're trying to portray an example, there is really no harm for a while to switch. I will not say that, you know, you completely take a different track and you start talking in Hindi. But then this is our language. This is our nation. Hindi is our language. I really don't think that it matters to a point that, you know, you won't get selected or something like that. So a little will not make a difference if you are carrying that same level of attitude, confidence, and you have the content and you have your knowledge of English.
I'm sorry, I got disconnected.
It's okay. Did I answer your question, Poonam?
Yes, ma'am. Thank
perfect,
you.
Perfect. So now, first, we'll take a few questions from the chat box. Okay. Anubhav, I think there's a question for you here. Mr. Amandeep has to ask that what do you suggest to a situation where people keep their thoughts with great ideas with themselves at workplace or home until and unless asked specifically? So how can we make them speak or push so that, you know, they can deliver those ideas that they have in their heads?
That's a great question. That's actually a great question, because the way you ask the question, for me, it's like an inverted cake psychologically. You know, it's layer by layer by layer that you have to cut. All right. So first of all, Amandeep, you need to figure out as to what your surroundings are. Right. कितनी बार होता है कि हमारे दिमाग में कुछ आइडिया आता है या हम कुछ बोलना चाहते हैं, पर सराउंडिंग वाले लोग ऐसे नहीं है कि वो उस बात को अडेप्ट कर पाए. राइट. सो योर सराउंडिंग्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. यू माइट हैव द ग्रेटेस्ट आइडियाज, बट यू माइट हैव पीपल हु आर नॉट केपेबल टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट पर्टिकुलर आइडिया. मेक श्योर यू ऑब्जर्व योर सराउंडिंग्स बिफोर यू प्रेजेंट योर आइडियाज, फर्स्ट. सेकेंड, after you've observed your surroundings, you'll exactly know what you need to say and how you need to say so that these guys actually understand that, right? So you need to present them in their own format, be it simple language, be it a language where, you know, you actually end up using a very high vocabulary, can be anything. Present them when you think what they'll understand. So that is the midway of this particular situation. How you can make them understand, first observe them and then answer. That's about it.
Aman, if you could please tell us if we answered your question.
Yeah, thanks. Wonderfully put up.
Thank you. Thank you, Aman. Okay, so there is this one more question from Siddharth, and he asks, what kind of communication is needed in business? Okay. So Siddharth, the answer to this question is pretty simple. There was actually a time where, you know, everything was pretty formal in our business area, but now a lot of companies are actually focusing on, you know, how to have a rather more open communication within the organization. So you need to draw the line where you are also being formal and frank at the same time, but then maintaining the standards that, you know, a MNC or a business organization would require. So again, the kind of communication here is going to be a mix, because companies are growing, their hierarchy is spreading, and they are looking forward to more open communication. But then you can't lose the fact that, you know, it's a business and it has to be formal. So that's there.
Can you repeat this question for me?
So the end of the question is, what kind of communication is needed in business? That's what I was answering.
And this is asked by?
This is asked by Mr. Siddharth.
Okay. Hello, Siddharth, first of all. Communication as an essence is a way from which you tell what you feel or what you think to others. It's just a way of expressing, right? Now, in business, if communication was the only key, you would not have people with the least amount of degrees holding the greatest amount of wealth. Mukesh Ambani, right? Do you think he mastered communications at some point of time? Or the guy who owns Kentaro, he used to go on a scooter selling the machine that he made to filter the water, the muddy water, into something that's drinkable. Do you think he is communication? He reached a certain stage from where, I'm not saying communication is not important. It is indeed important, but you need to have your content first. You need to be on a level after which you can present. Do you understand the point? Get yourself the knowledge and then train yourself, acquire that skill where you can talk in Hindi or in English or whatever suits you. or a mixture of both for that matter, but be fluent and be confident in what you're talking. You should know your stuff. And then your stuff, your knowledge, along with the skill set, will take you places. Thank you. Thank you, Sudha.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Anubhav, we have one more question coming from Mohit, and he's asking, does language matter while communicating? I want you to be a little more specific with your question. Communicating where? Are you in an office scenario? Are you with your friends? Are you in an embassy for a visa interview? Because that completely depends the language part.
All right then, are we done with the questions?
No, so Mohit has a question. Does language matter while communicating?
So let Mohit get a little more specific.
Yeah, because that's what I was asking. Mohit, do we still have you here?
Or how about let's answer his question, because I'm sure if he's asking that, and then it has to be...
I got my answer actually. Okay, so
that's perfect.
That's perfect. That's nice. Okay. Who is the speaking? Can we please know?
Ma'am Adruti.
Hi. What's your question, dear?
Yes, ma'am. So, this year I'll be sitting for placements. So, my question is, what are the key points we should keep in mind when we'll be sitting in front of the interviewer? Because you have already been recently, you have interviewed with Amazon. So, it will be a pleasure to know so that I can be well prepared before my interview sessions.
Okay. Mr. Sharma, would you like to go about it? I guess this is your favorite question to answer.
See, the point here is I can tell you to watch YouTube videos. I can tell you to read books. I can tell you to listen to podcasts. But tell me something. How do you know without a mentor or without taking coachings or guidance or mentorship, that whatever you're practicing in front of the mirror or by making a video call is right? You can be practicing everything all wrong and still be in that illusion that you're doing it right. My suggestion to you is get a mentor, get things on a speed track, let people who know stuff, let them notice what your shortcomings are. In an interview, when you sit, everything matters. Currently, in the time of pandemic, people have gone more critical. You need to know how to look into the camera, how to talk, how to express, how to formulate better language, how to answer situationally, and that how takes practice, that how takes guidance. So this is how it exactly goes. But one thing is for sure, that brush up your technical knowledge, brush up your theoretical knowledge, because that is one thing, even if it is 50% of your interview, you know that this is one thing that I can ace. So do that first, and side by side, what you can do is you can have basic amount of practice of how you talk, how you give your introduction. First of all, introduction is something that a lot of people think they know, but then they do not know it. It's like swimming. Swimming without a skill. You are on the edge of the pool. Your mind can tell you that you can float, but when you actually jump in the pool, that is the time you realize that, I don't know the skill. Just like public speaking, you go on stage, you think you can talk, your mind tells you that you can talk. But when the real time comes, you get a cold feet and you actually end up developing a fear. So, and how does it come? Get that skill set. If you think that you're doing wonderful, sit with somebody who can get you a session, who can assess you as to what are shortcomings. If you think you have confidence, well, really good. But get somebody to test that confidence. Only then you will know what waters are you floating in. Thank you very much.
So, Adair, I'll answer your question on a more practical front for you. Okay. So, see, one thing that you can really do before your interview, like a week before your interview, is give as many mock interviews as possible. Now, not just to your friends, but then someone who can, exactly how Mr. Sharma just mentioned, someone who can tell you your shortcomings. Okay. I don't know if you heard me, but then I was answering to someone else about having that shit system and organizing,
yes, process,
right? So I really did that for my Amazon thing. And it really worked out. I'll tell you why. Because these guys, the interview guys, they are actually assessing you based on the fact that how honest you're being, how truthful you're being, right? So when you have your thoughts organized and when they are penned down and there's no lie in it, that's when the interviewers know that, okay, you are very clear with the things that you've done during your, you know, post-grad, undergrad, whatever it is. So you just know that, okay, whatever you're speaking is pretty organized, conceptually, technically, that is there. Make the use of those shit systems. Have at least the common questions ready with you, like their answers, okay? Keep mirror practicing. Take care of your body language, because now this is our new face-to-face, being virtual. Take care of your body language. Improve on your communication. You can again do that by, you know, practicing regularly. Get yourself in front of a mirror. Practice again and again. Do a lot of mock sessions for me, I did it with Mr. Sharma. Similarly, you can have such trainers, friends, coaches, your own college people, you know, who can help you, tell you your shortcomings. So, yeah, I hope that answers your questions. If you have any other specific question in your mind, please.
Thank you so much, ma'am. One thing I have cleared in my mind that I should find a good mentor for me, because I don't have a good friend circle to whom I can talk and express my thoughts. So
it's all right. It's all right. Relax. It happens to everyone. And, you know, at some point of time, we always feel stuck. Situations are not good, but then the point is getting out of that situation, and there's so many people who will come to help you out. And if you're good with your technical knowledge, then just do what it takes and you'll reach somewhere. Don't worry.
Okay.
So, thank you, sir.
We have one more question from Miss Ashi, and her question is, how can one use pauses in their speech to their advantage? So, Anubhav, would you like to answer this question again?
Can you repeat the question? I could not hear you properly.
How can one use stutters or pauses in their speech to their advantage?
All right. This question is asked by who?
Ashi, Miss Ashi.
Okay. Hi, Ashi. So, the importance of a pause in a particular sentence or a speech is drastically important. How you start is, you start with a speech, right? And the importance is that when you start talking, so you get into voice modulation. As per the sentence, your pitch goes up or your pitch goes down. Now, when you take the transition of your pitch going up and your pitch going down, the mid part where you need to stop for the people who are listening to you, that is the point where the pause should come. Otherwise, your speech actually sounds like, you know, it's a constant audio tape without a comma or a pause. Even if you read from a newspaper or any place else, a pause gives you the feel of a comma or a full stop. So when you talk, that is the importance of a pause. You do not always go direct. You do not go like a train or a plane just speaking. You have to pause. You have to calm down if you're scaling up in a particular situation. Like if I give you a sentence, like how I would say is that hilltop was really, really, really magnificent. And I take a pause, right? The view was surreal. So I convey those emotions by that pause, right? I take you up and then I take you down. So you modulate your voice, you take the pause. Pauses are significantly important when it comes to showing emotions, transition from one emotion to the other in a sentence. That's about it, Ashley. I hope you got the right answer here and you're clear with it.
Okay, so Anubhav, we have one more question here that asks, what to do after graduation? One must go for job gain to gain some experience, then pursue his or her education, or first pursue for higher education and do job? Do you want to answer this question?
How about you start and then
I join? Sure. So, hi, Muskan. Okay. Honestly, this is a very personal choice. Because, so even in my post-graduation, a lot of companies, even Amazon, the profile that Amazon came for, that I actually got selected, it actually required an experience of 3 to 7 years. But then if you as a candidate prove your capability with your internships, then you have a chance of getting through. So my point here is that a few companies, even after your post-graduation, will come and ask for experienced candidates. Of course, not, you know, for like 5-7 years of experience, but they might ask you for 6 months or a year of experience or 2 years of experience. And then when a company comes to campus, they sort of know that, okay, this campus is known for hiring freshers. So they don't put up such requirements. So it's sort of always good to have some amount of experience, but then it's actually debatable. You can still have that experience with your internships. Now, if I have to talk culture-wise, like if I have to talk about the culture that India follows, a little more weightage goes on with directly pursuing your post-graduation first and then going for a job. Because in the Western countries, you usually end up with directly getting into a job after your graduation. You go for working about for good about 6 to 7 years, and that's when you, you know, go and pursue your post-graduation in one of the Ivy Leagues. But then if I have to really talk about India specifically, the usual pattern is that people generally go about doing their post-graduation first because that's where they get better opportunities. The second point here is that whether you are willing to go for a professional degree. So if you're going for a professional degree, something like, you know, being a lawyer, being a CA, CS, something like that, then you should certainly gain some experience and then go for your MBA or PGDM. But if you're entering into general management, I will have a little more weightage on, you know, going about with your post-graduation directly and then go in for a job. Have we answered your question, Muskan?
Is she there?
Yeah, she is there. I can see her. Okay, so anyway.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for... Hello.
Yeah, Muskan, we can hear you.
We can hear you.
Thank you.
Okay, bye. Thank you, Muskan. Thank you. Okay, I guess these were the questions in my chat box. Do we have any more questions that anybody wishes to go randomly?
We put the flyer here.
So everybody, if you want to reach,
if they don't want to ask publicly, then they just they can you know really contact.
So if we have a couple of you who you know if you are not comfortable, yeah, sure. I was just about to come there. So Mohit wants to have the link. So I'll just share my screen, and okay. So for Mohit and everybody else, this is actually where, can you guys see my screen now? Okay, anybody can tell me if you guys can see my screen?
Yes,
yeah.
Okay,
yes,
perfect.
Ma'am, it's visible.
So this is actually where you can reach out to Mr. Sharma and me. You just have to contact either on that email ID or on that mobile number. You can reach out to him. You can reach out to me as well via him. Both the ways.
You just drop a WhatsApp on that particular number with your name and your query. And if you want things to escalate, then we can take it from there. Let's keep it for 10 seconds approximately, 10, 20 seconds, and then we'll wrap this session.
Yeah, and just in case if anybody has any other questions, please.
I have a question for you, I think.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ask.
Okay. One problem that you always inquired in communication, and what is your definition to it? Like, how do you exactly, how did you tackle it?
So I think the problem that I've been facing for a very long time now, and that I still face, is the fact that, so when I'm overloaded with content and knowledge and information that I have going through in my head, it actually gets difficult for me to, you know, organizing it and then talking about it. Because when I have so much in my head, I just, you know, keep blabbering about it, and then it just becomes meaningless because people are not able to process it. So I think the root cause of it is that the problem is that I have a lot in my head, and I really don't know how to, you know, organize, you know, in an organized way, speak about it.
To what you already know, right? That's the core area that you're talking about.
Yeah. So this is
the knowledge, right?
Yeah. So this is the problem that I still face. I sometimes really have to tell myself that, Amrita, okay, slow down. Not everybody is getting through what you're trying to speak. So yeah, that's where the problem area lies personally for me, and I'm still working on it.
I'm sure. I mean, see, each one of you sitting here, you've had your own battles of success, failures. But remember, you cannot succeed if you've not failed. Everyone who's failed, you know, either they have succeeded or they've learned something. I would not call it failure. You're in 21st century. Groom yourself as per 21st century. Get those skills for 21st century. Get out of that cocoon and you will reach places. So let's, do you wish to close the session now?
Yes. And just one last thing. I really agree with what you said. For the girl that I was talking about, she had her own hardships, went through a lot of failure, and then she is where she is. And I am sure everybody who is sitting here today, I'm so glad that you guys, you know, had your time out to listen to us, to, you know, to have that courage of improving yourself. So really don't fear of failing, because that is your key to success. You can only succeed when you fail.
Think that everybody comes with an expiry date and a timeline. Do whatever you have to do. Trust me. Like, you don't have too many Sundays and weekends in life. Come on. Just do whatever it takes and live on your own terms. I'm sure you, if you can't find your passion right now, just think about it. You will find it at some point of time in your life. And all the very best. Thank you very much for your time. And you can get in touch.
Before ending on... Hello.
Yeah,
Muskan. Before ending, on the behalf of Air Cruise Aviation Private Limited and our entire team, thank you so much, both of you, for sharing your learnings with us and your findings and opinions too. It was a pleasure to have both of you here.
It was a pleasure, Muskan. Same here. We had an amazing time. I'm really receiving a lot of great comments. Thank you, everybody, for your love. This is really amazing. This actually made our day, receiving all this from you. So thank you for everything that you're putting up on the chat box. And thank you, Mr. Sharma. Thank you, Mr. Shekhar. This was pretty amazing. Thanks to the entire Air Cruise Aviation team. Yeah.
Right. Bye-bye.
Take care, okay. Bye, everybody.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
You want me to end the meeting?
Yeah, please. Okay. I was just actually waiting for Mr. Shekhar to, you know, okay. if he wants to say something, or we can certainly end this.
One, let me ask
him. Yeah.
I would just like to thank both of you for your wonderful words and wonderful guidance for our interns.
Thank you, Mr. Yeah, sure. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. I'll end this meeting.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.